I don't need to go into it. Hi, I'm talking about basically severe gram-negative infections. I'll start by I'm very simple in my talks, okay? Just to tell you at the outset, so you may be a little disappointed. I'll warn you that, okay? First is the recognition decision on urgency. I will postulate that simple clinical matter parameters and basic labs will most often tell you how sick the patient is. You don't need anything very fancy. When you walk into a room, you know when somebody is sick. One of the poorly utilized tools is blood pressure. Okay? You don't understand the value of postural doc. The lying down BP, 100. Everybody measures BP only lying down. People are not meant to get up. So horizontal BP is taken. You put that patient, when you don't know whether the fellow is sick or not, make him sit. Probably make him sit first before you make him stand, because he may just collapse when you stand. Sit and you'll see a drop. That tells you the guy is sick. If you see a guy tachypneic, tell you it's sick. So you don't need fancy tools to decide whether somebody is sick. Okay? Simple observation is more often enough. If sick, there is a clear urgency to respond with big guns. Early. Okay, I will not talk about what these big guns are now. But don't try and carpet bomb like the US does. Okay? Carpet bomb whole of Iraq. Okay, doesn't work. You'll get some Al-Qaeda starting in the process. Okay, and that is what is happening. You've got Al-Qaeda drugs, which are now Al-Qaeda organisms now. There's no real substitute for a decent history and a quick multi-system exam to try and figure out where the problem is. Don't get carried away with the empiric therapy often given outside. Weigh the evidence. Make your own evidence. Don't say that the guy has been on polymyxin plus this plus plus this plus this plus this plus. You discover the only thing left for you is to discover new drugs. Okay. So weigh the evidence. More than half the time, X, Y, Z is not required. Please remember that in our setting, gram-negative infections are clearly our commonest at most, almost every site of infection. Whether it is urine, whether it is blood, whether it is lung. Blood culture, the most important test. Take at least two separate cultures by a practical interval. That depends on how sick it is. If the patient is very sick and you need to respond fast, you're talking of probably 5 minutes. Or even two together, the volume of blood is important, because the more the volume, the more chance of the yield. If there is no hurry, couple of hours are very handy. I know there is a teaching that time is precious and 1 hour is the magic period. Even that teaching is changing slowly, because somebody slowly realized that sometimes you can wait. Other sites of sampling are based on clinical relevance, in basically from the history you get and from the examination findings. Don't pan culture. This is one language which has come. Pan culture. So a urinary catheter there for the last 2 weeks, culture. ET there for the last 3 weeks, culture. Okay. Obviously, it is going to grow various things. Okay. No self-respecting organism which will not grow. Potential sites of infection in an ICU. Patient has come with a de novo infection. That is the commonest cause. Okay. Then you get into certain other things. Line related, ventilator related, urine catheter related. Now, the urine catheter is probably the least relevant of the lot. Okay. Easy to culture, but very little information you'll get. It will grow. If a catheter has been there for more than 1 week, it will generally grow. And nowadays grows candida. Candida auris, candida this, candida that, besides the resistant gram-negative organ. So don't get excited about it. Perhaps better not to send it unless there is clinical evidence. Because in this day and age, to not treat is far harder, and to convince a third person not to treat is even harder. Remember the concept of a leaky gut. any sick person has got a blood barrier through which things leak. Okay, and it leaks straight into the blood. Now, don't forget that we are all very liberal with drug use. And the memory stays in the gut because there are millions of organisms in the gut. So invariably there are resistant organisms in the gut. Okay, and what is happening is that the resistance features are transmitting across genera. Okay, so it is not only E. coli transmitting to E. coli. E. coli is something is transferring to all kinds of things. And therefore, you basically got a zoo, and that is what is called the gut microbiome, which is now being investigated quite a bit, and there's lots and lots to learn about it. Okay, so you get transmission across species, and remember, plasmids are very promiscuous, if you want to put it mildly. So they transmit all kinds of things. So be careful of what you swallow. The single biggest example is if you are being very liberal with antibiotics with your family, everybody gets a cold. Okay? And you know that most colds are viral. But how many people can resist using an antibiotic? Because our microbiology teaching has been very good. We know streptococcal pharyngitis and the consequences of streptococcal. Kidney disease, heart disease, blah, 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 blah. Okay, fine. So take it easy. Most are not bacterial, most are viral. Want to get across to you some concepts in resistance to beta-lactam drugs, which is the single biggest family of drugs which is there, which you have to use. There is beta-lactamases, which are transmitted by plasmids, transposons. You also become, besides beta-lactamases, you get resistance because of porin mutations. You have efflux pumps. You have changing binding proteins. There are physical barriers to drug entry, like mucoid Klebsiella pneumonia, okay, which are not easy to treat because there is a thick layer of mucus around the organism. In other words, bugs are smart. They existed long before us, long before KFD came into the horizon. Bugs existed and they have survived. We've tried to carpet bomb them, but they have survived. Okay, so please understand that reality. So you cannot solve problems by carpet bombing, carpet bombing, carpet bombing, because you will have no bomb left, and which is where we are close. Two. You also need to understand a little bit about beta-lactamases. This is because this is more easily studied. I'll be simple. There is your class A. There is Ambler classification, class A, B, C, D. Class A is your TEM, SHV, CTXM, which is basically your ESBL group, which we see in India. And there is the famous KPC, Klebsiella pneumonia, carbapenemesis. Now, this is not our problem. This is a Western problem. KPCs are not our problem, we'll come to that. So we have a whole host of drugs designed for KPCs, but those drugs are not going to work great in our setting. Beta-lactamases, which goes by the name of IMP, VIM, NDM, NDM you know. Please understand that each of these groups have about 50 to 100 beta-lactamases in them. Okay, so there's a huge variety of beta-lactamases. We're not talking of one. Similarly, even NDM has reached 5. Maybe a few more are coming, waiting to be discovered. Okay, so we are not talking of one beta-lactamase here. Okay. The class C is predominantly cephalosporinases, and the class D is basically oxa-type, which means it's a hydrolyzed oxazolin. The most important, as I said, is the XDR gram-negatives. Now, you need to remember what I said is, in our settings, they usually carry more than one kind of beta-lactamases. So you have your OXA type, you have your ESBL type, you have your NDM type, and usually it's a combination. An average self-respecting troublesome bug has at least three mechanisms, three beta-lactamases of different kinds sitting here. treating them is obviously not easy. Okay, in India, the most common metallo-beta-lactamases and your oxetype, particularly 48 and ESBLs. These are our three predominant mechanisms amongst gram-negatives. The other problem you may have is that they're frequently, these organisms are frequently resistant to other unrelated drugs like aminoglycosides, quinolones, etc. because they usually carried in large plasmids which carry multiple things on them. So you're genuinely dealing with XDR. And the definition of XDR is that you've got less than two groups of drugs to treat with, and often, very often, near pan resistance. And occasionally pan resistant. What's the rationale of initial antibiotic empiric therapy? Please understand, though everybody likes to cover their backside, most importantly. Okay. It's impossible to cover all possible pathogens, however hard you try. So whether it's a hematologist, oncologist, marrow person, or whatever you want to talk, my patient is precious. I have to use everything known to mankind. Okay, it's not going to work. Background of patient is important. You need to send relevant tests early, not after too long. When you use drugs empirically, use appropriate dosing. The biggest problem is that drugs are used, the dosing is totally pathetic. Okay. Use imaging contextually. Okay, I won't elaborate into that. Also remember that you need to de-escalate once you get a diagnosis, or if there is no response to therapy after a few days. Fever is going on, patient is going on, you have used five guns. All five guns are obviously not working because neither the guy is not improving. Time to de-escalate. Okay, not only response to de-escalation, you need to de-escalate when nothing is happening. Very important, not there in the books. My own coinage, I don't know if OC will agree or not, but I think you need to de-escalate when there is no response. Because you are just feeding the gutter, basically. Not to forget adding costs. Difficulties in the XDR era. Combination therapy is prudent in sick bacteremic patients. Most useful when the organism is sensitive to both the agents. Very little benefit when you're talking of using combination therapy for resistant organisms. So if one has got slightly high MICs, you might be able to get away with higher dosing. I'll come back to this, okay, because I'm reaching this term back. So but the evidence doesn't, if you're talking of only one drug, only polymyxin there, and high level of carbapenem resistance or phosphomycin resistance plus other resistance, there's probably no dramatic advantage to combination therapy. But you may use it for other reasons. The question is, if you look at the data, you have to seriously think of using polymyxin in practically every Indian who comes to hospital, to an ICU. Is that wise? Is that prudent? And it's potentially disastrous, and we are seeing the consequences. So it's not infrequently that we see near pan resistance or pan resistance. It's not rare anymore. I'll address this topic also a little later. Choose wisely, individualize. We are in the era of individualizing therapy. Means you need to spend some time. And time is the most difficult factor for most clinicians. Invest time to sort out problems. Unfortunately, corporate medicine forces you into volumes rather than spending time. But that investment in time is good for the system, for the patient, and for umpteen other reasons. So there is no blanket formula which is there. You need to tailor therapy individually. What are the current options for carbapenem resistant enterobacteriaceae, which is our biggest problem? Many of the current strains, as I said, of carbapenem resistant enterobacteriaceae organisms carry NDM, OXA, 48-like beta-lactamases. polymyxin plus phosphomycin, if an MIC of phospho is less than 32, is probably the best choice at this point of time. If using a polymyxin, polymyxin B is the current preferred drug, particularly as there's no conversion step to active moiety. And the conversion is predominantly in the liver, and often the liver is involved in a septic patient, and it doesn't make sense to use it. Moreover, polymyxin B is probably less nephrotoxic than polymyxin E, which is your colistin. But remember, most sensitive reports will tell you about polymyxin E, that is your colistin, because that's how the thing is made. And then, and sensitivity tests are reported from the US where this polymyxin B is not available still. And therefore, we copy everything where somebody else is made. But the common sense is now is gradually shifting to polymyxin B. Meropenem is useful as a second drug if an MIC for some of these carbapenemase resistant organisms is less than 8. The cutoffs now are lowered. It is 1, 4, 8. As opposed to before 2010, 2011, where it was about 4, 16, 32. So the it's been formally lowered so that you don't need extra tests to identify potential carbapenemase producers. Okay, so there's a drastic learning lowering of MIC cutoffs started by the ECMID group, okay, and then now even CLSI. Okay, so everybody has lowered it, and therefore there's no hard recommendation to use the modified Hodges or other tests which are routinely, which had to be used before to identify this. If the MIC is greater than 16, it's better to use meropenem at a dosing of 2 grams every 8 hours as an infusion. Meaning, the logic is that beta-lactams are time-dependent killing, and therefore the longer you keep it over MIC, the better the chances of response. So infusion therapy is what is ideally recommended. It's not very easy because the patient is bedbound, and if he's slightly not too well, he won't agree. Not to forget there are line-related issues also. There's also talk of ultra-high dose meropenem dosing where you go up to 12 grams per day. May be used if there is an MIC greater than 16 to meropenem. But if the MIC is greater than 64, you're wasting your time and money. Okay, so this is up to 16 or so. What are the other options? Polymyxin B plus high dose tigecycline. The recommended 50 milligram Q12H's maintenance is not probably great at all. If you want to use, you need to use it as 100 milligrams Q12H. Okay, this is for carbapenem resistant enterobacteria. Ceftazidime, avibactam plus aztreonam. Now, what is the logic here? Ceftazidime, avibactam, I'm sure the drug companies are pushing you. Okay, Pfizer is coming 3 times a day to see you to push the ceftazidime, avibactam. Avibactam is a newer, more wider spectrum beta-lactamase, particularly useful for the OXA group, particularly OXA 48, which is a big problem in our part of the world. Now, what is the logic in this aztreonam? Here are references, important references. One is from abroad and one is from your group here, from critical care and microbiology group here. What is the logic in aztreonam? If you look at aztreonam on its own, it's not a great drug. However, aztreonam sensitivity is a good marker, indirect marker of metallo-beta-lactamase production. Okay, so things are resistant to everything, only aztreonam sensitive, it generally means there is metallo-beta-lactamase. However, most of our strains also contain OXA and a few other things. Therefore, using aztreonam alone, which is a monobactam, the other things will take care of it and kill the aztreonam before it reaches its site. Understand? So the logic in using ceftazidime, avibactam plus aztreonam is to use the avibactam to neutralize OXA kind of beta-lactamases and use the aztreonam for the metallo-beta-lactamases, which is our big problem. So the combined is often our big problem currently. It may change. There are other newer beta-lactamase inhibitors. Less data is there in the MBL section, in the metabolobeta-lactamase setting, but practically the relibactam, there is a imipenem-relibactam combination, there is a meropenem-rabrobactam combination. All these don't seem to act very well for your OXA, and they certainly, none of them are useful for your metallo-beta-lactamase, including ceftazidime-avibactam. So ceftazidime-avibactam is a poor drug for metallo-beta-lactamases. But what I'm trying to tell you is that the combination may give you some window of opportunity for some period of time. Other potential drugs which are out there, which are licensed, are plasmomycin, which is a newer aminoglycoside, which has not been released here yet. Irbecycline, which is a derivative of tigecycline, an improved version. Again, not useful for Pseudomonas, not useful for some things. Aztreonam avibactam, which is what I told you earlier, the aztreonam part for the MDL part. Metallo-beta-lactamase and the avibactam to neutralize other things. Is therefore has just been gone accelerated into a phase 3 trial just a few days before in the US setting. So there is some hope in the horizon. XDR, Pseudomonas, and Acinetobacter. Polymyxins are the cornerstone combination therapy for serious infections, and bacteremia if there is a sensitive second agent. Again, if you're talking high levels of resistance, the second drug does very little. For Pseudomonas, can try high dose of meropenem infusion as a second agent. There is some data coming out about ceftazidime, avibactam, plus phosphomycin for resistant Pseudomonas infections, XDR Pseudomonas, and it seems to be of some use. Okay. Otherwise, avibactam does very little to increase your spectrum of ceftazidime for Pseudomonas. For Acinetobacter, polymyxin plus high-dose tigecycline or minocycline or sulbactam, which is an old drug which is available on its own format, may be useful as a second agent. When there is CNS infection and lung infection, there is additional local instillation of polymyxins come in very useful because they don't reach these parts very well. And therefore, inhalation therapy or intrathecal therapy or intraventricular therapy is very useful. When I talk of XDR, I want to tell you about XDR salmonella because we are practicing in India. Okay, XDR salmonella typhi is a reality. It's a new problem evolving and spreading in the Sindh area of Pakistan. Understand, though we may not like them, it is not very far away. And it doesn't have to be as close as Shimoga and Udupi to become valid. Okay, it has also been described a little bit in Bangladesh. Now, what are we talking of? XDR salmonella. The definition is slightly different for salmonella typhi. When you're talking XDR salmonella typhi, you're talking of resistance to third generation cephalosporins, which is what we're relying on at present. So when you become resistant to IV ceftriaxone, your options are carbapenems at this point of time. And azithromycin still seems to be useful in the Pakistan setting at this point in time. Though there are lots of reports from India saying that there is a fair amount of azithromycin resistance. Because we use azithromycin very generously. Now it is used as an immune stimulating drug. Okay, so you know, there is a price for each unnecessary use of drugs. What are the secondary consequences of widespread polymyxin use? Obviously, resistance to polymyxins. Selection of organisms inherently resistant to polymyxins, that is Serratia, Proteus, Burkholderia, Chrysobacterium, Morganella, and Candida auris. New kid in the block. Not new kid, been around for some time, but spreading, widespread kid now. Clostridium difficile is now called Clostridioides because microbiologists like to change names every once in a while. Okay, otherwise they don't seem to be able to sleep in peace. Okay, 90-60 rule. Anybody knows what 90-60 rule is? This is borrowed from fungal experts. John Rex and company basically talked about it in relation to antifungal susceptibility. Interesting. Bear this in mind because there's a bit of philosophy here, but When an organism is reported as sensitive, there is around 90% chance of a good result. Now don't get carried away with the numbers, okay? 90% may not mean 90% because it depends on the host and a variety of other factors. When reported as resistant, there is still scope of response in about 60%. Again, don't get carried away with the numbers. Don't take 60 as a... So all is not lost. Choose appropriately. And there is still scope of response, even when you're talking of pan-resistant organism, as long as you do all the components, which are, if there is an abscess to drain it, or do all the things which are required, support, etc., 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 etc. Okay, so don't give up hope. It's worth trying even in the setting of pan-resistance. Cautious optimism, we need more rapid diagnostic tools, and there are quite a few in the horizon. In the US, the current fashion is next-gen sequencing. Okay, so you get one whole host of things. But there are a lot of algorithms which go with it, and some of them are actually not too bad. So it is not FDA approved, but it is approved by the American College of Pathology, and the variety of them are out there in the market. They cost around $600 or more, and they are of some use. There are newer polymyxins in the horizon which are less toxic. Aztreonam avibactam, which is getting accelerated probable approval. A new beta-lactamase inhibitor, VNRX5133, with activity against metallo-beta-lactamase on the horizon. It's in phase 3 trials, and that would be useful for us. Phage therapy, much talked about. But remember that phage therapy, though it started before much antibody therapy by the Russians, it went out of vogue because it's complex. Similarly, it's easy to say phage therapy, but you need things made for that organism if you want it to work. So it's very complicated. It's not as easy as choosing an antibiotic. You need a cocktail of phages to be used suited for the organism which you're dealing with. So it is not going to be useful for acute therapy, but for chronic illnesses maybe, and you need somebody who is very interested in it and will develop it more. Remember, clinical medicine is not past history, at least not yet. So whatever artificial intelligence you think, I don't think we are going to become extinct very easily. We need to try and stay ahead of the game by innovating, using tools intelligently, and thinking each time we use an antibiotic, whether it is justified or not. Probably prudent to be conservative at this point of time, rather than being liberal with antibiotics. So don't try and carpet bomb. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Open the floor to any questions.
Not thrown in anything controversial? Was he nothing?
It's a question from the audience, George. Dose and duration of azithromycin in XDR salmonella. I suppose it's salmonella typhi.
Yeah, it is at least 7 days. And it is usually 1 gram on the first day. I mean, some people say 1 gram every day. Some people say 500 mg. I think it's probably wiser to go higher.
Yeah, please use the doses different for if you're treating typhoid fever. It's 20 milligram per kilogram.
Yeah, 20 milligram.
So at least a gram of azithromycin per day for 7 days. It's not 500 mg on day one and 250 mg for the next 4 days. That is not the dose for salmonella typhoid.
So you clearly need higher dosing, as Ossi pointed out. And it's generally reasonably safe, but keep an eye on the liver. But remember that in typhoid itself, that you'll have some liver abnormality. So don't get carried away and say you can't use a drug. In the principle in all these things, the liver is probably involved to start with. So unless it's dramatically worsening, don't get excited with a little bit of enzyme elevation.
So one question. What has been your experience in Narayan Hidalia? Reasonable success with for these XDR organisms with these cocktails which you mentioned?
We've started only recently using the ceftazidime avibactam aztreonam combination. It's too early for me to give an opinion. Okay, because most of our patients really can't afford. So we've been more, but understand that polymyxin is toxic. Okay, I was recently using a polymyxin on a it's okay using polymyxin on a sick, slightly semi-comatose patient. He doesn't complain. Okay, but when you're using polymyxin on a conscious patient, most of them complain dramatically. The mild complaint is that they have got a funny feeling in their limbs. Recently, one guy was telling me, I have no head. He's telling me, I've lost my head. Okay, that's his complaint. I cannot use this drug. Okay, and it's true, it's got a lot. See, everybody talks about the nephrotoxicity. The nephrotoxicity is not as bad because usually it wears off with time. Okay, but the to go through CNS toxicity is not easy. Okay, and sometimes they're pretty horrible and they refuse to have it. So it's and then I had to resort to this combination and it worked. That's all I will say. What is your experience, OC?
Nalini will be talking about it in her presentation.
Okay.
One more question. Do you think antibiotics like chloramphenicol may need to be brought back?
Yeah, I'm using it periodically. Okay, because not brought back. I use it periodically because I have no choice. And I'm not uncomfortable about its use because I've grown up using it. Okay. Our primary drug of therapy for typhoid was chloramphenicol. So I've used tons of chloramphenicol. Can I swear that I have never had a problem? I can't swear. Okay. My observation always is that when you use drugs inappropriately, you get into bigger trouble. When you use it with reasonable indications, you get into less trouble. Why? I don't know.
One more question. Like, I think you didn't stress because of time. I think giving drugs to the patient with renal failure, I think you stressed me for so many times. I think what happens is somebody with the creatinine of 3-4, you start meropenem 500 milligram twice a day, and it goes on with the same dose, 30 kg versus 100 kg, same thing.
Yes.
I think point will stress on that.
Yeah. See, there's a perennial tussle between nephrologists and us. Okay. Nephrologists are worried about the kidney. There is no kidney to save unless the patient survives. Okay? So you don't modify drugs initially. Certainly first 48 hours to try and use some homeopathic dose is idiotic. Sorry. Okay? Use appropriate. The modification comes after not even one day, I would say at least 2 days. Then only the question of modifying doses comes. Okay? Otherwise, you basically have a non-working drug, okay, promoting even further resistance. Okay, so please understand that. Thanks, Vasudev. That is a popular theme of mine, which I forgot about, or rather, I had no time. Okay, fine. So we have perineal tussle, but there are fortunately one or two nephrologists who understand the logic. There are another two who don't understand it. And there's the biggest advantage is you have a tool called dialysis. Worst comes to worst, there is no tool for death other than prayer. Okay. So dialysis can always be done. It is not that terrible a thing. So temporary dialysis can always be done. But correct, again, you need more dosing when you're using on dialysis. I won't get there. Okay, any further questions?
Thank you, sir.